Thank you very much for the always thoughtful invitation from ICD that has been presented to me to be part of your deliberations during the Berlin Week, and at a time that I think we are all wondering what is happening to our world. And if I have followed this morning's sessions rightly, then I have become even more confused as to what Europeans would like to do in the face of the challenges, not only from Trumpism, but also from the kind of unraveling of the process of globalization that, as we have seen in the last few decades after the Second World War. As you heard a little bit from my introducer, you would know that my background is in the World Trade Organization, where I fought very hard. I fought very hard to change the way we treat the global trading system. Because before the WTO was conceived in 1995 agreement, it was the GATT, the General Agreement on Trade and Tariffs, that was the guardian of the international trade rules, as you will probably recall. And the GATT was called Richmond Club, because the GATT had a few rounds of negotiations, and most of the rounds dealt with the issues of interests of the advanced economies, mainly in the areas of manufacturing. Up until it was, at that time, the so-called Uruguay round, which has actually led to the agreement that for a change now, the GATT, the General Agreement on Trade and Tariff, was just a general agreement, would be turned into a global institution, a multilateral institution, and it was called the World Trade Organization, with the full participation not only of the advanced economy, but also of the developing economy. In the first few years of the life of the World Trade Organization, it was again led by another European person, a good friend of mine, a former trade minister and former foreign minister of Italy by the name of Renato Ruggiero, a very good man. But since that time, after Mr. Ruggiero, came the kind of demand for the global community that there should be a change in a way that this global institution should not be actually a monopoly by any particular country, neither by the European nor by the Americans. So this is how at that time, that was around the end of the 20th century, around 1997, 98, 99, that was around that period of time after 1995, when WTO was conceived. So my name was put up, and I never thought that I would be actually selected. But the time of change was there. The globalization process was taking its full steam, and there was a lot of expectation for the changes to happen at a global institution. There were three major ones. There were three major ones. One is a World Trade Organization with deals in international trade. The second one is a World Bank, which deal with the financing of development projects. The third one is the International Monetary Fund, the IMF. IMF has always been headed by a European. At the moment, a good friend of mine, Christine Lagarde, is the head of IMF. The second one is a World Bank, which has always been monopolized by an American. At the moment, he's a Korean-American or American-Korean by the name of Jim Kim. A blend, but most of the time it has been American, a former politician or American economist. It was only the World Trade Organization that has opened the way for people like myself, coming from the third world, in those days we call ourselves third world developing countries, to be selected to manage the organization. And I was sharing the term with another colleague who was a former Prime Minister of New Zealand by the name of Mike Moore. It was not given to me straight away, like a complete term of 4 years, but it was a sharing of term between Mr. Mike Moore and myself, and that at that time, United States yielded to this demand after many, many rounds of selection, interviewing me, me going around the world, giving lectures to countries as to what I was intending to do. I'm telling you this story because I want to contrast what happened towards the end of the 20th century and the beginning of the new millennium up until now. It's been the first few decades of the new millennium, that things are now going to change in a way that we may need to try to anticipate and to be able to do more as at those times that people were trying to actually make globalization work for the world. I came to the World Trade Organization with the intention that I wanted to make globalization work for the whole world. I want to make multilateral trading system work not only for the rich countries, but also for the countries that are selling just sometimes peanuts, selling cotton. In those days, as you know, many of the African countries were selling single products as export. Most of them are cotton, or sometimes some minerals, sometimes some fruits, but just single export. And they were not making it at the global level because they were not competitive. They could not industrialize. The moment they industrialized, their products were protected by other countries around the world, and they could not sell their products. At the same time, United States, Western powers, United States, European Union, they spend massive sums of money to subsidize their own farmers. So farm prices around the world were distorted in a way that poor countries producing normal farm products at the normal prices could not compete. Could not compete. So it was an uneven competition around the world that I want to fight against. And for once, when we began with our present round negotiation called the Doha Development Agenda, which was started in the year 2001 in the city of Doha in Qatar, it was meant to be the first development round ever for this global institution. And the first development round was supposed to bring in development agenda, meaning how we can make trade work for the rest of the world besides just for manufacturing countries, for industrialized countries. So one area in which we were tackling was to try to dismantle the trade distortions as embedded through huge subsidies. Europe in those days was subsidizing farm products to the tune of nearly 1 billion per day, 360 billion per year. United States did the same thing with cotton and other farm produce as well. So the first thing was to tackle how to liberalize trade in agricultural product, which is a mainstay of most European countries. And this, I can report to you that we have succeeded. At the moment, the problem at the moment is that the round is not yet completed. So the Doha round is yet uncompleted. We've been negotiating this for the last 15, 16 years already. This is the longest round that we have ever negotiated. It's not yet finished. But it has already an agreement that when the single undertaking is completed, part of the single undertaking would be the total elimination of export subsidies of the farm sectors. This is great, because it means that all of us who are actually dependent on farm exports would be able to compete with the bigger nations on a more equal terms, more equal terms. Secondly, we want to inject developmental elements into the Doha Development Agenda by way of doing a spatial attempt to make use of trade not only to enrich trading nations, but also to help in the solution for the medical needs in poorer countries, the so-called universal health care. For universal health care, you would need to have access to cheap medicine. But under the WTO rules and regulation, medicine could not be cheap because people have to pay rights, patent rights, very expensive, to the pharmaceutical producers, which are mainly in Switzerland, in Germany, in United States. They charge very high prices for their proprietorship of the patents, of the rights to be able to produce their pharmaceutical products at a certain level of prices that they could control. So the intention, the second intention, was to try to not to dismantle the protection of intellectual property rights. We cannot do that because it serves a good purpose to help encourage mankind to be able to be more innovative. But we need to be able to make use of the intellectual property right protections so that we can also facilitate the production of cheaper medicine for poorer countries to do their universal healthcare. And this we have succeeded also. We have exceeded in coming out with an exemption agreement on the TRIPS agreement. TRIPS is a trade-related intellectual property right agreement so that poor countries can gain easier access to the patent rights that have not yet actually terminated so that they can produce their own generic medicine at cheaper rates so that they can use them in their universal healthcare requirements. The third one is to make spatial treatment available to the poorest countries in the world. At the moment, we have around 49 the so-called least developed countries in the world. 49. Most of them, I would say, 37 are to be found in Africa. The rest spread all over the world, in Asia partly, in Latin America, just a few. But we need a special treatment for the LDC, the least developed countries, because they command just nearly 1.5% of the total trading volume, very minimum, nearly 50 countries. And so they need special access, they need special quota treatment so that they can gain in terms of selling their products sometime without having to compete in terms of pricing competition. So the third area in which the trade round, which is this round, has been doing is to grant spatial and differential privileges, what we call spatial and differential treatment, to the poorest countries, the LDCs. Number four, we want to allow poor countries to get on the bandwagon of industrialization process in the best possible manner, meaning that they should be able not only to export raw materials, they should be able to process raw materials. Like instead of exporting raw rubber, they should produce rubber gloves, they should produce tires for the cars and things like that. So in order to facilitate that kind of a processing industries, in this round, we have made a special concession that in converting raw material into finished products, the additional, what we call the effective rate of tariff, rate of tariff, should be as minimum, as small as possible. So that when you transfer, because when you transfer from the primary products into industrialized products, countries tend to hike their tariffs to protect their own markets. So we have actually been successful in saying that in order to have this transformation in processing raw materials into finished products, the level of additional tariffs should be at the minimum level. So these are a few things that we have been achieving in conducting this so-called Doha Development Agenda at the World Trade Organization. I left the World Trade Organization to become the Secretary General of UNCTAD, which is the UN Development Trade and Development Organization for the UN. The name UNCTAD is UN Conference on Trade and Development. It's being called conference because people don't want to call it organization. They want to keep us as a conference, so it's called UNCTAD. But UNCTAD actually served a purpose. When I came over from the WTO, I came with a baggage of the things that I have left unfinished at the WTO, and I continue with this kind of agenda at UNCTAD. What kind of agenda did I continue with UNCTAD? The first agenda, which, just to report to you before I finish with my conclusion for what is to be expected from the world in the next couple of years based on what is happening with deglobalization threats nationalist treatment and populist treatment in the new policies in the Western world. We have actually, I have been trying to implement the things that we have already agreed at the World Trade Organization, but not yet implemented. Because as you know, the trade round at the moment is stalling. It's a stalemate. At the moment, there is no single undertaking with the Doha round. So what I have said that we have agreed on are only partially implemented, not fully as a whole package. So I took with me some of the requirements that needs to be put in place to help the open countries. Now with the UNCTAD, I don't need to negotiate. Because at the UN, now, we negotiate on some things, but not always with the trade exchange. The one big area which I came from the WTO to UNCTAD was to try to enhance global investment. You know, I mean, before you can produce, before you can have transfer of technology, you need to have investment that could flow uninhibitedly throughout the world. And global investments are crucial because sometimes poor countries cannot mobilize their own funding for their own investment. And secondly, it's important to have international investment, what we call the foreign direct investment, because they come with a kind of transfer of technology that you can have without having to go through the whole process of purchasing them. You can have the foreign direct investment together with a kind of technology that you can learn outright. And thirdly, with a kind of investment flow that can be uninhibited, you can allow your own production network to flourish. Why? Because these days, you don't produce goods in only one country. You imagine a computer or an iPad or an iPhone. It's being produced in more than 10 countries, the parts of which are produced in parts of it in Vietnam, in Thailand, in China, in California, and elsewhere in the world, maybe finished somewhere in China. So all these equipments are produced as what we call in terms of international network of production. Through international investment, global investment, foreign direct investment, can a country get involved on the chain of production, the so-called global value chain, global supply chain? This day and age, the global trade volume is composed at least of 60% of global value chain. So if you're running a country, an economy, you better be linked with some chains if you want to progress in certain area to climb up the chain and not to be caught only in the lowest part of the chain, selling only cheap raw materials. So I carry with me, and I have actually enhanced the way we try to facilitate global trade, global flows of investment, foreign direct investment, particularly for the developing countries. At the moment, if we divide the global investment volume into two parts, one, the flows of investment into advanced countries, and one, flows of investment into lower-income country. The flow of investment into the lower-income countries take on more than half of the global flows of investment today. So there are more to it. We try to regulate it in a way that the open countries can participate. And at the UN, before I left, there was a set of rules, what I call responsible investment. Responsible investment, meaning investment in areas that are responding to the needs of the poor countries, that are linked to the raw materials of the country, linked to the skill availability of the country, so that it will serve a real purpose in creating value added for those countries. I went to the UN from the WTO, secondly, with the mindset that because country will need to compete, we all need to have the so-called a set of rules which is called competition rules. Linked with the competition rules, there is also a set of law that help to protect consumer interests, consumer protection. So what we need was competition rules and consumer protection law. So I went with that, and at the UNCTAD, We are the institution that look after the way we help the open countries to set up their own competition rules and consumer protection rules around the world. Thirdly, I went to United Nations with a mindset that in order to be able to compete successfully in the global community, you would have to be able to use international assistance, what we call international aid for trade. To use international assistance not only to do some constructions of some monuments in the countries or some buildings for the governments, but to do something to help, for example, to improve the facilities of ports, deep sea ports, so that countries can easily ship goods out of their own countries. Otherwise, they would have to carry it all the way to other ports, causing a lot of transportation costs in the meantime. So we did facilitate a lot of international aids that would go towards enhancing trade competitiveness of all those countries, training skills for traders, trying to help in managing custom procedures in a way that custom procedures would not be a block, a blockage to trade, but should be a facility to help in transferring trade throughout the borders. Now, these are some of the ideas I would like to leave with you, that organizations like the WTO, an organization like the one I used to manage as a Secretary General, the UNCTAD, could be useful as a multilateral organization to help create development around the world so that we would have a more equitable, inclusive world in which all countries can share in the gains of globalization that all these speakers in the morning have been talking about. Why do we have to do this? Because if you leave globalization to the world, or just to the world markets, you would see that multinational firms, transnational firms, some of which are larger than even the production size of a country, if you leave globalization to the marketplaces, you would see that those who have better technology, those who have access to more capital, will benefit from this globalization. That's why Kofi Annan, a former Secretary General of the UN, used to say that globalization has not actually lifted all boats. It has lifted some boats like the yachts owned by the rich people, and it has sunk some of the poor, the smaller boats. It has sunk the smaller boats, the ones that are not well equipped to stand the tides of globalization. So this is what I would like you to understand, that there is such a system in the world today that we try to put in place so that we can create a world which is more equal, more inclusive, also of gender, also of youth employment, also of those countries which are LDCs, least developed countries, countries that are island states, that are dependent on some very difficult transportation network, that some are landlocked countries, the so-called landlocked economies, that are very poor because they cannot have access to the maritime transportation. Countries like Nepal, countries like Laos, PDR in Asia. So here is a system in which we try to help manage globalization process so that there is a role for the market which helps to determine the prices, and there is a role, what we call developmental role, for the states that should help to accompany the market rules and regulation so that countries can be equipped to be competitive. But as we see in the last couple of years, particularly since the time of the Great Recession, 2008-2009, we've seen that the market left alone, and left alone in the way that the market have become more managed by the financial flows rather than by the real production of goods, of manufacturing goods, merchandise products, but more managed by financial policies, turning the kind of developmental process on its head, so that finance rule over predominant over real investment, real production, that things would happen like what we saw with the demise of the financialization of the economies, like what happened in the United States with the so-called subprime credit that has actually spawned what we call shadow financing, has led to a plethora of unclear, shadowy financial instruments that finally ruined all these banks that have been speculating with the money of their depositors. It came about because of the fact that financial flows that determine the real sector did not actually help to determine the way that real sector should get allocation of capital in the right way. But it determines the way the financial sectors are producing their own products and using the products to exploit the way fund flows could happen around the world with less and less rules and regulation. The deregulation process that had happened in the United States last few decades has helped to spawn all kind of what they call swap agreements, derivatives, securitized instruments that are based on some shady loans that sometimes are not actually fully disclosed. Still today, you see banks around the world are still being penalized for the way they have misled their investors into investing into some of these derivatives that has created a lot of losses for the depositors. So at the moment, we are seeing this process being influenced by the new way of thinking. Since after the Great Recession 2008-2009, there has been what they call the new normal situation in the global economy. The new normal situation has this implication that the global growth will be slower. You can see minimum growth, just sometime 2%, sometime 2.5%. This year they said it will be more than that. You see a new normal that many of the advanced economies have not been able to gain positive growth at all. You have seen double, triple recession in Europe, in the EU. You have seen that movements in currencies that have gone to create what they call currency wars, that people would prefer to have their currencies being devalued and devalued so that you can sell your goods at cheaper prices than your own competitors, what they call beggar thy neighbor economy, which is so disastrous for the global competition on the global trading system. You see the kind of increment accumulation of borrowings by the poor countries, because in the slowing down of the global growth, in the contraction of the global trade, poor countries could find less means to earn their livings because they have to find a niche in their international market, since the contraction and slowing down of the trade as being influenced by the deflationary impact because of the recession. The poor countries have been in worse shape than the rest of the world. So what happens is that instead of having a leveling of the level of wealth around the world, there has been an explosion of inequalities around the world. And this is, at the moment, the greatest, and I emphasize, this is the greatest enemy of mankind, inequality. Inequality not only in one's country, but inequality around the world. As Oxfam has stated, and this morning somebody was quoting it, at the moment, 8 richest persons in the world owns wealth to the amount that is greater than is owned by half of humanity's 3.5 billion people. Their wealth, just about the size of the 8 richest men of the world. And this used to be a few hundred richer men in the world own half of the global wealth. It used to be a few hundred richer men. It used to be like this, 200, 300 rich. It became 100, it became 50, it became 30, and the latest figure is at 8. So the world is moving in the wrong direction. And it's just what I described in the beginning, I hope you recall, that we were trying to make the world more equal. But what's happening at the moment is even less equal. Now, after the Great Recession, after 2008, most of the advanced economies, they had to save themselves, save their own financial system. I mean, banks were actually collapsing every day in the United States. In Europe, they were not collapsing, but they lost a lot of money. They had huge NPL, non-performing loans. They're still saddled by all these NPLs up till today. So financial system has been weakened, and what happened is that they put in a lot of liquidity, what they call QE, quantitative easing. They eased the monetary policy to the level the interest rate were kept to the lowest level, close to zero. Some countries today, like Japan, conduct their interest rate policies at the negative level. Do you deposit money with a bank? The bank does not give you the interest payment, but the bank asks you to pay. This is the negative, just to make sure that people don't only save, but just invest money. But what this kind of policy, excessive stimulus, has spawned? It has spawned huge amount of liquidity in the last 10 years, that are not being absorbed into the economies of the richer country. Why? Because the richer country had huge debts. Household debt, public sector debts, corporate sector debts. And in those last few years, they were trying to deleveraging, unwinding their debt, paying back their debts. It's a long-term process because it was huge. So at the moment, the process of deleveraging the debt issue is not yet finished. So the money cannot be absorbed into the corporate society, into the manufacturing processes, enough so that they can create new products. So what happens is that the excess liquidity that has been pumped into the system, that was supposed to have gone into manufacturing, has gone into reviving the economy, has gone into helping to stem the tide of deflationary demand, has gone into the assets prices. You see what happened? That if the liquidity doesn't go into real production, it will go into stock trading, equity trading, private equity, go into speculation on the land prices, all these assets that are owned by richer people. So what happens after the crisis? The stimulus that has actually spawned huge liquidity has created even more inequalities around the world. You have to follow this a little bit because this is really a crucial issue that I'm going to drive at. So inequality at the moment is at the apex of our society. Whatever people are saying about Trumponomics or Trumpism or the breaking up of the European Union or whatever, I think the crux of the matter is that we just will not survive if our society would be driven by this kind of policies that would drive us apart. Because the more we differ in terms of our riches, wealth, the more people will get frustrated. There'll be more protests, there'll be a billion people protest, we are against the Wall Street, all kind of protests that we've seen around. There'll be more Arab Spring, much worse than Arab Spring, 10 times, 100 times most. Because the richer people are getting richer quicker than the poor people who are getting poorer all the time. And this is not being helped by the kind of stimulus measures, I would say, it has been made even worse by the stimulus measures, QEs, the so-called quantitative easing. US done 3 times QE3. $3 to $5 trillion of dollars have been spawned out into the market, and the US cannot use the money. The money has gone into the stock markets and to equity, into asset pricing, houses and everything around the world. It has distorted the price of asset, but it's made the asset owner richer. And the asset owners are not income wage earners. So what we are seeing in the world today is that asset owners and wage earners on one side. the share of wage earners, or what we call the shares of income, compared to shares of asset rents income. The share of wage income has been contracting all the time since after the crisis. Productivity has not been increasing. There is, it's been very little breakthrough in innovation, in technology. So there's been little enhancement of productivity around the world. So wage level have been staying on the real term, rather put, unchanged, whereas assets income has been going up all the time. You look at the stock exchange in the US. Just the other day, yesterday, I think it was announced that since the crisis, stock exchange, the Dow Jones index in the US has gone up by more than 200%. How can it perform this without the US economy having actually recovered? US economy is beginning to recover, was beginning to recover maybe last year or this year with new employment being created. But how can the Dow Jones have gained by 230% in the last 10 years? It's just mainly because of the funds that have been driven there. And if you happen to own, or you can have access to the piece of papers, ownership of companies, you're gaining. Is this fair? This is certainly the most unfair policies in the world, but it is being perpetuated. At the moment, US has stopped doing the kind of QE, and because of the need that they think that there be more employment and the threats of inflationary impact, they are beginning to hike interest rates for the second time since the Great Recession. And this year there is expectation that US Federal Reserve will probably hike interest rates again by maybe two or three times. But in Europe, they are still doing the QE. If you listen well to this morning discussion or some of the discussion going on in Europe at the moment, Mr. Draghi, who is the governor of the Central Bank of Europe, the ECB, he's a bit torn at the moment because European recovery is a little bit taking some shape, not really a real recovery, but it's beginning. So he's a bit under pressure by the disciplinarian economy. I wouldn't mention names in the European Union, that he would have to increase interest rate. But at the same time, he has economies that still have not actually recovered from the past recession. And there are quite a number of them in Europe. So Mr. Draghi, who is conducting a very low interest rate policy, cannot actually stay away from quantitative easing, even more so. But he cannot say that I will continue with it, so he's just keeping mum at the moment. So the question is that there is still Europe that goes along the easing way, US going along the austerity way. Japan is also going on along the QE way because they thought Japanese yen was very expensive. That has actually priced Japanese product out of the market, has created two lost decades for the Japanese economy. So at the moment, what happens in Japan, Abenomics is only just pushing down interest rates into the negative terrain and pushing up the rate of inflation in Japan. They want to have inflation more than 2% in Japan, but now they're reaching only 1%. So this is the situation of the global economy today. I mean, in spite of what I've been doing and a lot of our colleagues around the world have been doing to help promote trade for development, to promote the UN development assistance in a way that we can help to promote competitive trade for the poor countries, get the poor countries more on the negotiating tables so that they can partake on the benefits of trade. It happens a little bit, but it has been more than overcompensated by the loss of income because of the past few years of anemic growth in the global economy and contraction in the global trade share. Now, there are at least, I would end by just warning, give you additional warning and maybe just a little bit of solution, what are we supposed to be doing? I have been talking to some of my colleagues around the world in the last few months, and people like Larry Summer, Professor Summer, you must have heard of him. Larry Summer is from Harvard University. He's been saying just recently, end of last year, What he said was this, and I quote what he said end of last year. He said, the events of 2016 will be remembered either as a point at which we began to turn away from globalization, or the one at which that strategies of globalization began to be reoriented away from the elite towards mass interests. This is his wish and his hope, that because globalization has spawned a lot of inequalities around the world, and because of the appearance of Brexit and appearance of Mr. Trump, Professor Larry Summers was saying that last year was a year that people were fed up with globalization, so there was this turn away from globalization, or otherwise to make globalization survive all this, it would have to be managed in a way that globalization will serve the mass, the poor people, interests of the poor people. I also would like to quote another colleague, Professor Francis Fukuyama. You know Francis Fukuyama from the book The End of History. After the collapse that our colleague here, Mark, was talking about, the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989, end of the Cold War, Francis Fukuyama became very famous with his book called The End of History. He said, this is the end of communism, so there is no more fight between communism and liberalism, neoliberal economic policy. So this is Francis Fukuyama, and he actually also showed news concern as what can happen in the future. And this I quote, in America and Europe, this is Francis saying, in America and Europe, elites made huge policy blunders in recent years that hurt ordinary people more than themselves. Deregulation of financial market laid the groundwork for the subprime crisis in the United States, while a badly designed euro contributed to the debt crisis in Greece. This is what Francis Fukuyama, who has now changed his tack from the end of history into the renewable of new history now. Now is another kind of history. It's not the fight between communism and market capitalism. It's not a fight, it's not a big fight against inequality. Mark Carney, the governor of the Bank of England, he joined in this kind of remark in referring to the current decades as the first lost decade since 1960s. He said that it was incredible that real income has not risen in the past 10 years with a growing sense of isolation and detachment among people who has felt left behind by globalization. I can go on with quotes from different friends around the world that I have been reading in the last couple of months as to their disenchantment with the globalization process and to their concerns with how the new trends towards nationalism, isolationism, protectionism, deglobalization would produce. There are five key challenges that will require global attention and global concerted attention and I would say joint policy making. The first one is the one that we at the UN has been discussing all along, even before the crisis in 2008. This is the need to have fundamental reform of market mechanism. Fundamental reform of market mechanism. We have been growing under the belief that market mechanism is godlike. It knows everything. It produces a kind of information that everybody knows. It gives us the right pricing. It gives us the right allocation of resources, which is actually it fails to do because times and again, it produced crisis after crisis. It has produced inequality, I have explained. It has slow productivity growth. It has not produced a kind of human development policies that we should be seeing. It has produced of pollutions at the level that we would probably be not able to manage in the next couple of decades. So fundamental change in market mechanism will have to be engineered. But who's going to do that? Because at the moment, like I said, financial interests rule the tide. Financial interests rule the tide. Greed is good. Greed is good. This is the cradle of the market. You more greed, yes, you have to have more ambition. Not enough is enough, but greed is good. Everybody has to consume more, save less, consume more, which is this totally wrong thing. But we need to change this mindset. Secondly, we need to rebuild communities, because communities these days have deteriorated because the loss of jobs, loss of income. You look at communities, United States, which has lost their manufacturing base, all for lawn houses, deserted houses, municipalities. Some of their municipalities have become bankrupt. There's a nationalist sentiment that people would like to do, buy us first, buy our goods first. Don't buy other goods. Don't lend to other countries. Lend to our own people first. They all turned inward. A lot of social insecurity, a rise of populism, and that's why it's explained why the UK people. And it's very strange, because it happens to the middle-aged people in the UK that have voted against staying in Europe. Why the young people, they have hopes, they vote to remain in Europe. But all the people, they vote to leave Europe, because they have lost their income, they have lost their meaning of life and the way that they can manage to stay productively employed. This is the need for us to rebuild communities, and that's why the kind of meetings that you are participating at the ICD is so crucial, because we need to rebuild ourselves together using all kinds of means and cultural means, cultural diplomacy, the way we need to exchange our culture more, to understand, so that we would have less of a deficit in our understanding. And we'll be honest and more sincere. We can build actually with our honesty and honest approach, knowing each other's problems, because we all have problems. We all have problems, and we need to share our problems in a way that we can share the way our cultural tendency will help us, to guide us, to join our hands in a way we can solve things together. The third one is technology. Every day when I go around the world these days, people were talking about disruptive technology. Technologies will be disruptive. They'll be disruptive in many ways. They're now using the drone to send products around the world. You know, and drones to attack people, to fight and everything. And these days, some of the medical fields are going to be left to the robotics, because they can read X-ray film better than medical doctors. So people will go out of work. This morning somebody was saying, I don't believe that automation would drive people out of work. Please, read all the OECD, World Bank reports, all kind of reports. They would say that, particularly in the United States, 47% of the jobs in the United States as a whole are at risk of being lost because of automation. There'll be driverless car, you know. The robotics is actually expanding like there is going to be no frontier, no limit. They're going to do everything for you, and they are going to have the so-called AI, the artificial intelligence. They learn. They make the mistakes, and they learn from their mistakes, and they correct it. I love to play chess. I think some of you know, but at the moment, grandmaster of chess or the world champion of chess are losing games to chess computers. And computers are thinking better than human beings in many fields that we are using computers, particularly in medical fields and in many fields. This will be disruptive in many ways. Banks around the world are closing their branches. You know, in the past, banks used to open up branches. Now banks are closing up their branches, because you can do the financial technology, the fintech. You can do PayPal. You can do peer-to-peer payments without going to the banks. In the future, the bank will become like just only one machine. You go there and you use the machine, it will perform all this kind of thing. So this is happening, and the banks are closing down. Otherwise, they do their own mobile banking, which is using less and less of the premises that they have. So this is really disruptive. Number four, geopolitics. I have to say anything more. Geopolitics is actually getting in the ways of the normal global governance that somebody was talking this morning. I also subscribe to the same idea. We need to go back to the old global governance, but at the moment, geopolitical movements and policies are driving us apart. One example I just read in the newspaper just yesterday or this morning, that let's say the trade between two major trading nations like China and Korea are now being stopped because of the geopolitical situation. That because of the nuclear tests in North Korea, US has to build the kind of shield for South Korea somewhere close to the borders. And so the Chinese think this is a threat to China, so China has been retaliating against goods imported from Korea. And tourists going from China to Korea are now blocked, not be able to travel. So, I mean, this is just a minor example, but geopolitical threats all around, all over the world, between countries that are actually in hostility against each other. And Trumpism may exacerbate what is happening in terms of deterioration in the geopolitical situation, because Mr. Trump might withdraw US from the, for example, the climate change agreement in Paris that was undertaken 2 years ago, which is one of the best climate change agreement ever undertaken, and some of the nuclear deals that US might like to withdraw from. So geopolitical tension will get in the way of global economic governance. And the last point that I certainly would like to remind you is the need to really accelerate our actions against the environmental degradation. Every year, there's just one fact that would have to be always in our mind, that every year you have seen that this is a hottest year on record, and it's every year. It was a hottest year on record in 2014, it was a hottest year on record in 2015, and last year, 2016, another hottest year on record, and you would see in 2017 the same thing. Because we are just moving not according to the Paris Agreement, as you'll be seeing some of the evaluation process going on at the moment. People are walking away, they are all, and somebody was saying this morning, the subsidies that we have given to fossil fuels are not going to be whittled away or reduced. The reduction in oil prices help us a little bit, but it doesn't help us in the way that we'll be tackling the reduction in the use of fossil fuel. The lower price of oil has actually helped to spur more use of fossil fuel, which is a sad thing. Although countries are now taking away subsidies, oil prices are cheaper, so the replacement of fossil fuel by renewable energy sources is not happening at the rate that we would like to see. You see now countries that are living by the water, like Fiji, like Kiribati, Maldives, and some of these islands, they are moving people away from the shore all the time. Very costly exercise, because the water coming higher and higher, and the roads sometimes, if you go to some of the specific island countries, you are seeing some of the roads now under the water by the beach, and have to construct new roads up on the higher level. They don't have hills, but they have the shores, which make things a little bit difficult for them to do something else rather than moving people away and keeping them safe all the time. All this are happening in terms of challenges. Inequality, communities, nationalism, disruptive technology, geopolitics, environmental degradation, at a time that we are not actually making our global multilateral cooperation functioning. Last year, there was this G8, G7 summit in Japan at Isoshima, G8 summit. You would have thought that this top people would have sat together and solved the whole problem. First, they talk about global growth. They talk about global growth, nothing happened. They talk about global trade expansion. Don't do restrictive trade policy. Don't put obstacles into trade. Don't do retaliations. They went back to their countries. Everybody put up their own obstacles and trade policies that have become more restrictive. They were saying we may need to help poor countries more so. They all go back home, and what happens is that they reallocate their funds development assistance to poor countries, to infrastructure building in their own country, which is not bad, because they will have to say, well, we first. I don't think we should ever blame Mr. Trump for saying America first. He is honest in saying so like this, America first, because everybody is doing the same thing, I can assure you. But they don't say this. How can you go this and say in your parliament, or go to the international meeting and say, I'm going to do this for my country first? But politics is always local. Don't forget that. I have lived with all these people so long that I understand that whatever they say, international communities can be forgotten. We all will have to live with this kind of world in a way that we may be seeing, not at the moment, it seems, you know, recovery is nascent. You're not going to have a really sustainable growth in the United States? No, because there is no participation from the labor force. Labor force participation in the United States is about the lowest in the last, I don't know, couple of decades. People not participate. New jobs created in the United States are what we call the hamburger flipping jobs. You know, the kind of unstable job just for a while, temporary jobs. And not really stable jobs in manufacturing. They were saying now they're producing more cars. Yes, they're producing more cars, but because of investment from Japan, from Korea, producing cars in the United States. My own countries. We have retail businesses that are buying up all the retail department stores around the world, including from Germany, Italy, and France, and everywhere else. We have seafood processing, canning industries that are the largest in the world, buying things. This is a world in which we may need to help save ourselves in a way that to be dependent on what the global hegemonic power can solve. I think if we can say that the hegemonic power, if they can stay put, do not create more problems, stay put, so that we from the South, the European countries from the South, can join hands, and join hands also with the North, to produce more input. And this is what's been happening since the Great Recession. When there was this new normal, advanced countries are growing less fast than before, emerging economies are growing much faster. China, Brazil, Mexico, Indonesia, South Africa. This is some country, India, growing faster. But at the moment, again, these are countries that are suffering also from the malaise in the world. Now it has spread all over the world. So emerging economies that used to carry the weight of the new recovery, of the new growth in the global economy, are not doing so. China is going through a very difficult, painful adjustment process. So that growth used to be 10, 9, 8, 7. This year is going to be 6.5, not so much so. And all these other countries, Brazil is in recession for I don't know how many years already. And this year I was told Brazil will be probably in deeper recession than before. And so on and so forth. So we're seeing the world, I mean, economic is a dismal science. And being an economist, I cannot help but just to give you all this bad news, so to check you up a bit, make you wake up and see what you can do to put pressure on the global community. For me, I intend to do this on behalf of the UN. The one system that is going to save us all is the UN system. As bad as it is at the moment, it's not the best system, but it's the only one that functions to help put us together, 193 countries. Instead of G8, G7, G20, I don't know how many, they're going to solve the problem for some of those Gs, but not for the whole community. They're not going to build roads. They look at Wall Street. They don't look at countries with no street to walk on. And we are the one from the UN that look at countries that have no voice. We voice on their behalf. We build roads for them to walk on, and not only looking only at the Wall Street. So it's only at the UN that we can construct and reconstruct the global economy. And that's why the Agenda 2030, because this morning I didn't hear anybody talk about Agenda 2030. Agenda 2030, transforming our world, is a crucial agenda. It is composed of 17 goals. Somebody was mentioning some goals this morning, but you go and look at the 17 goals. And these are goals that cover from social to environmental, to economic development. gender equality, the quality of education, quality of water, all this sort of thing, the level of inequality. In one of the goals would have to drive up the salaries, the income of the country, not the national income, but the income of the lowest earning people, 40% down. There are a lot of goals like this in the sustainable development goals. And I wish and I hope that everyone would learn all this goal and try to make sure that your own country, your own region, and also other countries will have to implement the same policies so that we can drive forward growth with development, with equality, and also with the preservation of the environment. Thank you very much.